The US military is the most powerful in the world on land, sea, and air. But when it comes to the air, they have a big problem. An aging fleet of aircraft spanning multiple platforms across three branches of the military. Their answer? The Joint Strike Fighter Aircraft Program, the most ambitious, expensive, and controversial military program in history. We're talking about replacing the F-16, the A-10 Warthog, the FA-18 Super Hornet, and the AV-8 Harrier, among others. And not only would it have to meet the needs of the Navy, Air Force, and Marines, but also appeal to foreign militaries around the world. It all sounds good on paper, but the reality has left some wondering if this grand unifying philosophy was a huge mistake, and whether they bit off more than they could chew. And let's not forget about cost, which would make even Warren Buffett blush. With an estimated program lifecycle cost of $1.5 trillion, it sure isn't going to help beat down the US national debt. And yes, that's trillion with a T. As far back as the late 1980s, the JSF program was conceived as a way to replace multiple aircraft with a single base aircraft that had three variants, each with their own technical requirements. The F-35A Air Force variant would be for conventional takeoff and landing, have stealthy capabilities, and be intended primarily for air-to-air dogfighting and close air support. The F-35B Marine variant would be for short takeoff and vertical landing, and is intended primarily for attack missions and the ability to take off and land with no airstrip. And the F-35C Navy variant would require foldable wingtips, carrier takeoff and landing capabilities, and is intended primarily for attack and fighter missions. And whenever you have a design by committee across multiple branches of the military, there are bound to be some compromises, especially when trying to combine several aircraft roles into one do-it-all Marvel jet. But in theory, they would be acceptable compromises, or at least that was the line peddled by the military program managers and the aircraft manufacturers. One major promise was to keep the cost of the aircraft, training, supply chains, and maintenance low, all hinging on the idea of high part commonality. Many other promises have been made both from Lockheed Martin to the Pentagon and from the Pentagon to Congress. Let's take a look at some of the more controversial ones. A cost of about $50 to $70 million per plane in 2017 dollars. Air-to-air, ground attack, and close air support capabilities. Stealth technology, sensor fusion for a high-tech view of the battle space, less expensive operational cost over legacy fleets, and of course the 80% part commonality between the three variants. The actual plane cost, depending on what article you read, is quite alarming. Estimates now put the cost anywhere from 2 to 4 times what was originally stated in 1994, and that's adjusting for current dollars. Now, the air-to-air dogfighting capability of the F-35 has gotten a lot of press from both sides. In 2015, in a leaked report where one F-35A test pilot went up against a 40-year-old F-16D in an intimate mock dogfight, the pilot reported lack of maneuverability, unable to come out victorious against the F-16. But in 2016, 31 F-35 pilots were interviewed, and every one of them would take the F-35A over former jets in most air-to-air combat scenarios. There have been numerous reports since, not surprisingly, on both sides of the argument. When it comes to the dangerous close air support mission, a fair number of A-10 Warthog advocates believe there is no plane currently capable of replacing it, the F-35 included. They cite the F-35's lack of armor plating and paltry 181 rounds on the smaller 25mm cannon, as well as the inability to fly low and short loiter times, aspects they say the A-10 excel at. But F-35 proponents would say that speed, stealth, maneuverability, and sensor fusion would give the F-35 a distinct edge in ground support missions and the ability to fly much higher, often employing smaller, more precise bombs. Lieutenant Colonel Raja Chari, director of the F-35 Integrated Test Force, had some interesting comments on the A-10 versus F-35 debate. If US forces are fighting in a high-threat environment, the A-10 isn't really in the conversation. And regarding low-threat environments, he says, if you are talking a non-contested environment, you are going to have tankers. You could easily get to 90 minutes if you are 15 minutes from where you are going to loiter. And a former A-10 instructor pilot said the situational awareness aids associated with the sensor suite of the F-35 allowed pilots to execute close air support missions as well or better than the A-10 in low threat environments. And although more than half of the 280 A-10s have been re-winged to keep them flying potentially into the 2030s, there are plans for a face-off between the two planes later in 2018, which may result in a much earlier retirement of the A-10. According to outspoken F-35 detractor Pierre Spray, stealth is a scam. It simply doesn't work. Spray cites the F-35 as being only stealthy in the X-band, but not in other radar frequencies, potentially making it vulnerable to much older tracking technologies. Lockheed Martin and the Pentagon counter by saying the F-35's strengths lie in the ability to go undetected, giving it first look, first shot, first kill. Retired Marine Corps Lieutenant Colonel Dave Burke, a former Top Gun instructor who has flown the F-35, F-22, F-16, and F-18, had this to say. It's really difficult for me to overstate what a massive advantage you have in decision-making in the F-35. But we need to remember that even the best stealth does not make a plane invisible to radar or other enemy sensors. However, it usually means it can be detected at a much shorter range, and when detected, doesn't necessarily mean the enemy can engage. The reality is that stealth is just one important ingredient in a much larger recipe. A smart strategy builds a detailed virtual blueprint of the enemy's electronic order of battle, and then designs the mission to take advantage of the strengths of the aircraft, stealth being just one of them. So what about that nearly $500,000 helmet and this fancy thing called sensor fusion? The oversimplified idea is that the F-35 will take inputs from several different sensors on the plane and merge them into a single display, right inside that sexy helmet, rather than separate displays for each sensor, as seen in the current generation of birds. In addition, each F-35 would be able to share information with other F-35s, creating a more broad and confident picture of the threat environment and potential targets without the back-and-forth lag of radio communication. But in a 2016 memorandum, the Pentagon's Director of Operational Test and Evaluation, Dr. Michael Gilmore, outlines many of the aircraft's faults, including several issues with the sensor fusion system. For example, pilots were seeing two enemies when there should only be one. In response to that, the chief of the F-35 Joint Program Office, Lieutenant General Christopher Bogdan, said there were no surprises in the memo, and the JPO is currently acting on all the recommendations. Since many of the sensor fusion issues seem to be software related, it is likely that most of these will be addressed before the planes are put into full service. But when, and more importantly, how much will it cost, are the big questions. No doubt these fixes will balloon the program cost even further. With the legacy F-16 costing around $20,000 per flight hour, the estimated cost of $42,000 per flight hour for the F-35 is more than double now, a far cry from the original promise of lower than legacy operational costs. And remember that promise of 80% part commonality that was so compelling? Well, now a number of reports indicate that number is closer to 25%. Seems like yet another broken promise. But was the JSF program inherently flawed or even necessary in the first place? In a 2013 study by the RAND Corporation, they found that it would have been cheaper if the Air Force, Marine Corps, and Navy had developed three separate aircraft to meet their specific and varied requirements. For instance, the STOVL requirement of the Marine Corps resulted in a compromised design for the Navy and Air Force. A single engine with thick bodies and short wings are some reasons why there are so many criticisms around the F-35's maneuverability and reliability. And there were alternatives to the entire program. For instance, older planes like the FA-18 Super Hornet could have been retrofitted just like the EA-18 Growler with modern avionics and electronic warfare equipment. But that's water under the bridge, and all the Monday morning quarterbacking won't change the fact that the program is marching forward. And let's not forget about the so-called budget death spiral. In order to keep the cost per plane low, Lockheed needs to produce and sell a lot of aircraft. But if the defense budget shrinks and the government cuts orders, the price of each plane goes up. And when the price of each plane goes up, you guessed it, the government cuts more orders. And this cycle typically keeps repeating itself until you have very few planes on hand and you have spent a buttload of cash. This vicious cycle is not a new phenomenon. We saw it happen with the F-22, and it's already happening with the F-35. Where the program will end up when the last domino falls is yet to be seen, but it's not looking good. And with that, some of the biggest financial value propositions have vanished into the contrails of the sky, and many of the technical ones hang in the balance. But all the technical and financial controversies are not even close to the whole story. There is something more powerful at play here: the military-industrial complex. That term is often thrown around willy-nilly, but what does it really mean in layman's terms? Simply put, it's the working relationship between three entities: the military, arms manufacturers, and the government. But another very important layer to this relationship is not an entity, it's the economy. And it's a very tasty carrot on the stick of this seedy, thick as thieves arrangement dangling in front of politicians. In the case of Lockheed Martin, they have spread out F-35 part manufacturing over 46 states and 9 foreign countries with a total of some 1,300 suppliers, creating upwards of 150,000 jobs in the United States alone. But they didn't do this for manufacturing logistics or efficiency reasons, regardless of what they might say publicly. Instead, Lockheed has gotten very good at what is called political engineering. This crafty, bipartisan-friendly strategy makes it very hard for senators or congressmen, be it Democrat or Republican, to oppose the program, because that would risk losing jobs for their constituents and ultimately jeopardize their re-election hopes. That whole power thing is mighty powerful. Mix in the fact that you have three branches of the military invested in a single program, and canceling it becomes a near impossibility. And that is why the F-35 Joint Strike Fighter program cannot be stopped, and why the program has been dubbed too big to fail and too big to kill. The F-35 is rolling off the assembly line as we speak. Some pilots will hate it, some will love it, and some will just learn to live with it. Despite what the extreme talking heads say, it's not a terrible plane, nor is it the best that could have been purpose-built for each branch of the military. Instead, it's a very expensive, all-in-one solution that has compromises, some expected, some not. And it's here to stay. Given that the F-35 is intended to serve the US military for decades to come, will we ever see another manned fighter program? Or do you think that we are on the precipice of change where drones will be able to fill the role of fighters, bombers, and attack aircraft of today? Is the F-35 the most expensive military aircraft mistake ever made? And what would you like to see from us in future aviation videos? Let us know in the comments below. And if you enjoyed this video, we would be honored to have your subscription. We're 2-Bit Aviation. Thank you for watching.